The program that we lovingly call still the Regis Dialogue Program has a long history here. And, of course, the Regis Foundation's funding of it from 1994 to just this past year has been an extraordinary component of it. But it's something that I love this document we put together because it sort of describes a little bit of what the program is about. And it says just that it's celebrating the most dynamic, innovative, and influential filmmakers of our time. In 1990, with funding from the MacArthur Foundation, it became established as the Dialogue and Retrospective Program. And it was then picked up in 1994 by the Regis Foundation to support it and then called the Regis Dialogues. This was just an array of people who have been here. We do have posters that go up to the current time, adding the new filmmakers who have joined us on this very stage to talk about their work. And one of the things, again, they come and talk not only about their work with clips being shown on the stage, but also we do as much of a retrospective, hopefully a full retrospective of their work, depending on how large of a body of work they have at that time. What an amazing list of people. It is incredible, isn't it, Bruce? I mean, you started this program in 1990, this part of it. I know you talked a little bit before of having some precursors to getting it kind of rolling with bringing filmmakers in, and then this kicked off with the MacArthur grant. And
Yeah, I'd love to at least have for the, so to speak, historical record that there were several of these done before we actually applied for the money and decided to move forward. And I have to say, one of the most important ones was this one with Jonathan Demme, where we actually produced a volume. This was just done for us. And the essay was by Pauline Kael. And what's so interesting is that we invited Pauline Kael to come, and we said that we'll bring all the Demme films. We're going to do a little screening cycle of Demme. And she could pick excerpts from whatever she wanted. And she said, I only want, you know, like these two from Melvin and Howard and this, you know. So she really had very particular notions of that body of work. They came. It was a rather extraordinary night. And then a couple of years later, I bumped into Demme. And he said, you know, my family down in Florida, they never really thought I was a success until they saw this book. And then they realized that I actually had achieved something. Well, we began with Clint Eastwood for, I think, a couple of reasons. One, I already had a good contact for him in the critic Richard Schickel, who had been here with Arthur Penn, another one of these kind of precursors to doing the dialogues. And we had a back and forth, and I said, you know, I'd really like to have Clint Eastwood come in because, among other things, I think he is, in some ways, the missing link between old Hollywood, the kind of, the sort of veteran directors of the 40s and 50s, of some of whom he had to work with, and the new Hollywood. And also, one of the things that this should be about is taking things that we think are ordinary and seeing the extraordinary in them. And the fact that Clint Eastwood is mostly seen as an actor, but actually has a more than robust career as a director, you know, having recently then done Bird. He was in pre-production for The Unforgiven when he came and did the Regis, the MacArthur Dialogue, and I will say it was spellbinding. Merchant Ivory, and James Ivory in particular, were probably the closest thing we had in this country to a kind of homegrown art cinema, because we often think of art cinema as being, oh, it's Scandinavian, or it's French, or it's Italian, but Merchant Ivory Productions was a very concerted effort to make a certain kind of quality picture, and that they were, you know, based in the U.S., albeit, you know, shooting, you know, all over the world and making some of the most extraordinary contemporary drama. I thought, you know, we need to celebrate this, and we need to have, you know, a retrospective to look at their work and to hear directly from James Ivory, who's usually the silent partner, even though he's directing these pictures. So it was a chance to have James Ivory speak about their vision and his legacy. Jodie Foster had just finished her first film as a director. And I thought, actor-director? Well, we had Clint Eastwood. He's an actor-director. And it was really through our connection with Jonathan Demme that I could ask Jodie Foster. So I contacted Demme. He said, I'd be happy to make the contact for you, make the connection for you. So we invited Jodie Foster to come, and she had, again, just finished Little Man Tate. And we wanted her really to talk a little bit about her work behind the camera, but especially about her extraordinary career from child actress to a kind of major star. And the great surprise with her, she came without an entourage. She was happy to be here. She was not in and out. She actually stayed in the community several days. She went to a high school and did a reading and talked to those students about the importance of education. And she just spent a great deal of time here in the museum. Ed Pressman, in the period that we were beginning this project, was a major figure in the burgeoning American independent feature movement. He had put his money and made his money in Schwarzenegger films, but he was now starting to produce all sorts of small-scale independent features. And I thought, we need to have a moment not only to celebrate and acknowledge his contributions, but to get some sense of the vision that connected such a varied output that had come from him. And also just to hear his story. And his story partly is that he is the son, the scion of Pressman Toys, which was kind of a major part of American popular culture in the early part of the century. And now the son was producing a kind of popular culture for the latter part of the century. Keith Carradine is part of a dynasty of actors, starting with his father, John Carradine. And it seemed like a wonderful chance to have someone who's never quite been a kind of major figure, but has been in an extraordinary number of important films to speak about his work. And we had just a small window of time. He was in the musical on Will Rogers. And in fact, he was every night of the week in his Will Rogers mode. And we had to kind of catch him on some, I think it was a holiday moment or some moment that allowed him to be outside of Broadway or, in Minneapolis in order to do this. And he'd just been in a wonderful film called The Ballad of the Sad Cafe. So it was a chance to kind of catch him at, I think, a really high point in his film acting career. John Sayles is probably, I think, among the most influential independent filmmakers in American cinema. A writer-director, came up in the kind of Corman school, writing low-budget exploitation films, deeply committed, working in a particular mode of filmmaking that was telling a kind of social history with the camera. And he had just finished a film called City of Hope, which I thought was brilliant. And I saw this as a great moment to bring him here to highlight a little bit of that exploitation background with those alligator and piranha films, but also to acknowledge the centrality of his practice for independent film. Ken Burns was here with Terrence Rafferty, who was writing for The New Yorker, and I can only call that evening adequately a love fest, because I don't think we've ever been in a space here at the Walker or at any film festival I've been to in the world where there was such extraordinary love and warmth and gratitude projected from the audience to the maker. And Ken Burns was telling stories and showing sequences from his films and pulling out letters, Civil War letters from his pocket, and engaging us in every possible way about a brilliant nonfiction practice that was our story being imagined by or being recast in such extraordinary ways by this very, very gifted nonfiction filmmaker. Wim Wenders was on our short list forever. But it ended up taking about 2 years to bring him here because he was still living in Germany then and having an international practice. One of the major figures from New German Cinema, one of the major figures from contemporary cinema. Someone who absolutely understood not only the medium, but actually the cultural milieu from which it came, an incredibly engaged, enlightened and lively individual. And we were able to bring Jim Hoberman from the Village Voice in to be his interlocutor in what was maybe among the very, very best nights I've witnessed for a dialogue. Danny Glover, another actor who had been in an extraordinary number and great variety of films, commercial films, independent films, a very resonant figure on screen. He had been in a few films that I thought were exactly the kind of films I wanted to highlight. So I invited him, and he happily agreed to come. I brought from the City Sun the film critic Armin White. And what was so amazing about Danny Glover is Danny Glover is one of those actors who never sees the finished film, who, for whether it's the superstition or just how they handle their professional practice, he never had seen his finished films. And here he was sitting on stage, and we were stopping every 10 or 15 minutes and seeing, you know, 4 and 5 minute sequences of very powerful acting by Danny Glover. And after one of these, the lights came on, and there was Danny Glover in tears because he remembered when he had made that, when he had done that scene, his father had died, and he was thinking of his father, and seeing the scene brought him immediately back to, it was Places in the Heart, brought him immediately back to that moment, and he just realized how, in some ways, how much of his own life was there up on screen. Robert Altman is probably the most important figure who, in American cinema, who had a kind of uneasy relationship to the business of film and was at the same time a master of filmmaking. He was enormously successful and then by turns incredibly unsuccessful, but he kept at it. And we were able to bring him in right after he finished The Player, which was a kind of, you know, yet again, a kind of comeback vehicle. And he is funny, he is lively, he has, you know, he started out as an industrial filmmaker, so he knows the business inside out. He has a commitment to actors, he has a commitment to writing, and that mastery of the medium, and also that kind of, you know, extraordinary spirit that he has, and that extraordinary storytelling skills that he has on screen were well evident in our dialogue. Marcel Ofels is internationally recognized, Oscar-winning nonfiction filmmaker who has focused his lens on passionate parts of our history, dramatic parts of our history, the most important Holocaust films, and some of the kind of most compelling nonfiction films of the last 20 or 25 years he's directed. I brought Philip Lopate in from New York, who's a critic and writer, and they went deeply into the context for these films, and I will say there was probably the most in-depth, almost scholarly attention paid to the details of the films and their making and the histories that they told, and it was a night for Ofelsians everywhere to kind of understand in quite some detail the nature of his practice. Liva Ullmann we think of as the muse to Ingmar Bergman. She's in some of the canonical Bergman films. They had a personal relationship for many years. She was about to go the other way in that she was about to become an auteur. So the name of it, from actor to auteur. She had worked on a film called Sophie, using other players in that stock company of Bergman's, and was really here to tell her story. And her story is that she felt that in those films of Bergman, she was Bergman. So she already understood aspects of the artist's eye, the artist's sensibility, in playing those roles as an actor. And so for her, the transition to directing wasn't that much of a challenge. And as we got to see when we saw her work, but we also got extraordinary behind-the-scenes glimpses into that intimate working relationship and into, you know, some of the, again, kind of major pieces of contemporary cinema. Julie Dash and Lindsay Law in American Playhouse. American Playhouse was one of the great experiments in public television to create a platform for the production and exhibition of quality independent feature films. And one of the films that they supported was the work of Julie Dash, of her Daughters in the Dust. And the chance to have the visionary, because he really was, executive producer of American Playhouse, Lindsay Law, with one of the major filmmakers of that period, gave us a chance to look at kind of both sides of the picture, how to create important new films, and then how to create an audience or provide a context for an audience to experience them. Chen Kaiga was among the two or three most important contemporary Chinese film directors. He had gone to the Beijing Film Academy. He was classmates with Zhou Yimou. He had extraordinary, you might say, cultural credentials. And he came, I think, at a very high moment for him with a film, Farewell My Concubine, which I think had just taken a big award at the Cannes Film Festival. And it was, I think, one of the most dramatic of the dialogues because at one point during the dialogue, he had to talk a little bit about his backstory. And probably the hardest thing for him in his life, and also one of the most moving things I've seen in the dialogues, was talking about the Cultural Revolution and having to denounce his own father, who was a poet, as part of the training that he was going through in the kind of Cultural Revolutionary days in China, and how he had to kind of pick up the pieces when he became an artist himself. Jim Jarmusch is a kind of iconic figure in American independent film, the ultimate road picture maker, who had, I'd say not only an uneasy relationship with Hollywood, but an uneasy relationship with institutions in general. So it wasn't a simple matter to have Jim Jarmusch hop on the plane and come here to the Twin Cities. And I remember meeting him at a dive bar in the Lower East Side to discuss what it was that we wanted and how we might actually do this. And I was actually extraordinarily grateful that he took the time to be with us. And we brought Jonathan Rosenbaum, one of the great contemporary film critics up from Chicago. And it was a lively evening of film and film stories and film references and excerpts from Jim Jarmusch's body of work. Jane Campion is, I think, originally from New Zealand, but was living in Australia. And in order to even reach her, I remember I'd have to get up at ridiculous hours of the night to make phone calls to her office. It probably took almost 3 years from the time that we first invited her for her schedule to work to allow her to be here. I was an enormous fan of her work, really believe that from her first short films, her early film for television, her first theatrical features, that she was among the most brilliant filmmakers on the planet. And so I so wanted to have her here at the Walker and to have her in one of our dialogues. And we finally, the stars aligned and we were finally able to bring her. And when she came here, she was here with Richard Pina. And as it turns out, not because of any personal lack of interest, but she'd never publicly spoken about her films. And so she was, by turns, giddy and emotional and engaged and charmed by just the experience of being here and also of seeing her work and being able to talk directly about her work. Haile Jerima is an African filmmaker who was part of what's now called the L.A. Rebellion, that is the filmmakers who came of age in the 1970s, who were studying at UCLA, who began to make their work as student thesis projects, and who emerged as major figures in the late 1970s and early 80s. And he continued to make work about history, about the histories of oppression, very powerful work, very powerfully wrought work, really unique, singular work. We were able to bring him in with his cinematographer, Arthur Jaffa, and to have a conversation about the nature of that practice. And it was really, I have to say, really an enormous opportunity for us because he had just finished a film called Sankofa, which looked at the slave trade and I think was and maybe remains his most powerful and most successful film. And Jeska Holland is a Polish-born filmmaker who's been working in France for many years, had done, I thought, some of the most charming and insightful historical films, films like Europa, Europa, looking back at the Holocaust, but taking a very different narrative approach to telling those stories. And had made several films that showed not only the lineage with what we used to call the Polish school, people like Polanski, but also a kind of singularity in her filmmaking. And I wanted her to come and talk about that practice. Also, to give it a name, there aren't a lot of women that we associate with the European art film. And I thought, here's a master of this mode of filmmaking, and let us have her here. And she came and spoke with Amy Taubin about her work. And we actually had an area premiere of a film that she made with Leo DiCaprio. It was the very next film he made after Titanic, a film called Total Eclipse, which was a kind of poet's biopic about Rambo, about Arthur Rambo. And it was kind of a brilliant film that no one ever saw because of the way in which it was released. But we had a great moment to see the film, but also to understand the context of its production. The Quay brothers, Stephen and Timothy Quay, are two twin brothers, originally from the Philadelphia area, who've lived in London most of their lives, who specialize in a kind of stop-motion animation that has all sorts of cultural relationships to the 20s and 30s, and who had done a singular body of work that had developed a cult following but wasn't widely known. They were starting to move from short films into features, and I'd wanted to bring them for years. I always thought they'd come to the Walker on Halloween, but, you know, one can never make those things happen. So they came in the middle of winter in February, and it was a particularly cold winter. In any case, they came, and because it was so cold, the critic from New York said that he was afraid to fly. So with about a day's preparation, I became the onstage interlocutor of the Quay brothers, and we had, needless to say, amazing work to show. And they just finished what was then their first important feature, or the first theatrical feature, Institute Benjamenta. So we had a chance to premiere that film. Gordon Parks is a legendary photographer, the first African-American filmmaker to work in Hollywood, one of the first filmmakers to work in blaxploitation, and a kind of incredible activist for the power of images, whether it's work he did for Life magazine or work he did for the cinema. He believed in the power of images to change lives and influence people. And we got him, very fortunately, toward the end of his life. He was still active in photography, and we were able to have him sit down and walk us through a rather extraordinary career of as a filmmaker, and talk a great deal about his other practices. And we were able to have Susan Robeson in this community as the interviewer in what was a very moving evening. One doesn't think of Tom Hanks as an art aficionado, but he actually was very interested in the late de Kooning show that was here in the museum, and arranged to come after hours with Richard Flood, our head curator, to look at the exhibition with his wife, Rita Wilson. And I forget, it was one or two other people, but it was a very small, it wasn't much of an entourage. And we're walking around, and I have a chance to chat him up a bit. And I said, I heard that you've just finished a film. He said, yes, I've made a little film. I really like it. I think it turned out well. I said, well, how would you like to come back to this place and show the film and talk a little bit about your work? Sure. So he came back, he showed That Thing You Do, and more importantly, he actually sat down for a Regis dialogue with Richard Schickel that was extraordinary, because, you know, every aspect of his career and his art as an actor, it was on the table.
And all, I don't mean to be flip towards your answer, but I was able to become a director from the safest of all positions. I was a movie star the studio didn't want to piss off. So I got to go and say, I'd like to direct this movie. And they said, yeah, okay, Tom, we'd love you to direct the movie.
And it was, I would say, probably the single liveliest evening I can recall in this space with Tom Hanks. Spike Lee almost single-handedly brought about a kind of sea change in our understanding of what constituted American independent film practice in a massive body of work that has, I think, more than stood the test of time. A writer, a director, a producer, who's always brought his family, whether it's his father composing, a sister acting, has a kind of community that he's developed, has discovered major actors who have gone on to major careers. So it was really time to sit down with him and have a kind of look at the nature of his practice, the kind of arc of the work he was doing, where and where he saw his filmmaking going. And this was actually the very beginning of the advent of a certain kind of digital editing, and sort of all sorts of things were changing in the world of film production. And so we had a chance to hear a little bit about that too.
You could do the guerrilla filmmaking route and not ask for permission, not ask for location scouts, but I mean, location fees and that kind of stuff. I mean, we didn't have any. We just shot with she's got to have it. And I think that when a young filmmaker starting out, that's the way you have to approach it, because if you don't have money for that type of stuff, you just got to shoot.
Peter Greenaway is really an artist turned filmmaker. He was a painter. He was interested in writing. He was engaged in almost what we'd call kind of conceptual practice, but began making short films in the early 70s, supported by the British Film Institute and various funding groups in London. And he had developed, I thought, an amazing body of work, beginning with his first theatrical film, The Draftsman's Contract. And he had just finished a film I'd seen at a festival called The Pillow Book, and I thought, we must have him. I'd heard him give lectures. I'd seen him in Q&As. He's incredibly articulate, incredibly opinionated, and also incredibly funny from time to time. And I thought, let's have Peter Greenaway and Peter Wolin. Peter Wolin, who is a film scholar I'd studied with, but also was a filmmaker. He was the co-scenarist. How about co-screenwriter on Antonioni's The Passenger, among other things. But he also had made a film with Tilda Swinton called Friendship's Death, and a film with Laura Mulvey called Riddles of the Sphinx. Anyway, the two Peters to talk about essentially two very different sides of British independent filmmaking. You know, Jessica Lange is from here, and I couldn't imagine a better actor to highlight an amazing career, someone who actually understands the nature of her practice, and who's really gone from, complete commercial assignments like being, in King Kong's hand, to having done extraordinary work in a whole range of films, some of them independent, some of them commercial. And she graciously agreed to come.
Yeah. And you were nominated for an Academy Award. Who won that year? I think you should have won.
Thank
you, remember?
You, Molly. I do, of course I remember. I remember every year I do.
You know all the numbers.
And we brought Molly Haskell in from New York, and they just had an amazing time talking about a very impressive body of work. And then we got to show a preview of what was then a brand new film that she'd done in England called Cousin Bet. Abbas Kiarostami is a major figure in international cinema, in the forefront of a generation of filmmakers who had begun film, had begun a film practice before the regime change, before the revolution in Iran, but who had emerged only in the 1980s and early 90s to kind of have this international acclaim. He had, most of his films were shot in little rural areas. There were small narratives about young people, mostly boys, very small incidents in their lives, but observed with such an extraordinary eye and with a sense of finding narrative in the least likely places. So I'd wanted to bring him. But because he's Iranian and because this country was having all sorts of issues with Iran, it was almost impossible for him to travel to the States. And he came to the Walker Art Center, and only to the Walker Art Center, because Joan Mondale was on our board, and she agreed to ask her husband, Walter Mondale, to make a phone call, and he did. He contacted the American Embassy in Paris, and through the embassy, they were able to jump the hurdles or prepare the paperwork that allowed Kiarostami to come from Tehran to Paris to Minneapolis. And he was enormously grateful, as was the audience in the house that night. Claire Denis is the only filmmaker of the 20 or so that we that I worked on for the first decade and a half of these dialogues, who didn't come. She was making a film in Djibouti, in fact, probably the most important film of her career, and couldn't understand why I was upset with her. I did call her a couple of times in Djibouti, but it wasn't going to happen. So we showed her films, brilliant filmmaker. And of course, as you can attest, she eventually did come and participate in a dialogue. But I think one of the great contemporary filmmakers, extraordinary sense of narrative construction, deep social commitment, deep understanding of the lives of outsiders and of marginalized people, and a very creative storyteller. Terry Gilliam was the only American who was part of Monty Python's Flying Circus, and he was a very gifted animator, a young man who was interested in comedy, a young man who was interested in filmmaking, and had on his own created an extraordinary body of work. So coming to the Walker was like a homecoming for him. And I remember we actually did a little bit of driving around and kind of perusing the Minnesota that he remembered before the family moved to California.
Today, you actually located the house you grew up in,
yeah,
by Medicine Lake.
Yeah, this tiny, tiny little place out Medicine Lake. And strangely enough, it's one little area out there that hasn't seemed to have been touched by development. We ended up on the wrong road to begin with, and there was no shape of this memory of mine. And finally, we had to call a friend of my parents who had called the newspaper to say she would tell me where I used to live if we gave her a call. And they took us to this place, this tiny, tiny place. It was this wee little place.
And he was nothing short of dazzling in talking about his work, in, you know, pulling the curtain back to the creative process and giving us a sense of the genuine wildness of his imagination and the extraordinary creativity that he brings to the screen. And Stuart Klawans, a very gifted critic, was on hand to conduct that incredibly memorable dialogue. You know, Stan Brakhage is like the father of American experimental filmmaking. He, in his lifetime, made over 300 films. Began in the 1950s, had a practice that was literally half a century long, and has a story to tell. It's about taking the medium in hand. It's about using it to tell different stories, including stories about family and about self. And it was a great privilege for me to be on stage with Stan Brakhage, conducting that interview, showing excerpts from films that are, for film students and people engaged by the American avant-garde, canonical: Winter Water Baby Moving, Mothlight, Dog Star Man, Text of Light. And he was incredibly open, incredibly generous, about the context in which the films were made, about his own modest upbringing, about his coming to a realization about the power of the medium and his commitment to film. My swan song, the last of the dialogues that I directly oversaw, was a two-day visit by the German filmmaker Werner Herzog. And I will say it was... maybe we saved the best for last. Roger Ebert was the critic. Didn't get any better than that. Herzog and Ebert, two incredible, as Andy Warhol would say, two incredible talkers, because Warhol liked talkers, but two spellbinding storytellers. And they were in their spellbinding mode, the two of them. And so it was an evening of extraordinary tales, great images on the screen, and it was the occasion for Werner Herzog, who was making a certain kind of nonfiction film. He called it directed documentaries, which is to say they were fabricated, they were manipulated, they were cooked, and yet they seemed very real, and they seemed to have important lessons in them. And his decision to come here allowed him to kind of put together what he called a kind of manifesto of his practice, of this nonfiction practice. He called Lessons of Darkness, and he actually gave the subtitle Minnesota Declaration, Truth and Fact in Documentary Cinema. It is issued at the Walker Arts Center April the 30th, 1999. And to this day, it's a document as important as the Dogma 95 of Lars von Trier, as important as any statement about contemporary practice, about blurring those boundaries which we see now everywhere within contemporary filmmaking, those boundaries between fact and fiction, and showing that if you had to choose, maybe fiction would be the way to go. Maybe it's better to have the truth than the reality.
So I'd just like to tell you a little bit about what kind of the film filmmakers who have been here since 2000, 1999, 2000, after Bruce left. I picked up the program and added the very first person I brought in, didn't do a dialogue at all. Of course, he did a monologue because he's known for that. And it was John Waters, who, it was the 25th anniversary of Pink Flamingos, and a perfect time to have John Waters come and talk about his films. Next, Léos Carax from French, a French filmmaker who had just finished a film, Pola X. And he'd been very well known in the 1980s for all of the works he did, Boy Meets Girl, Lovers on a Bridge, and had just this amazing new film called Pola X, and someone that I was really thrilled to be able to bring. I lived in Paris in the 80s and was excited to see those works at that time and to go meet with him in a Paris cafe and ask him to come and talk at the Walker Art Center. And was thrilled that he accepted and was able to come out here. And then we did a full retrospective of his work as well. Next, Doris Dury, the German filmmaker, whose film title for this we called Straight Through the Heart. And really because she is a filmmaker who goes directly to the heart of storytelling and tells stories purely from the heart. An amazing film. And we did a premiere at this time of Enlightenment Guaranteed, which was her film where she goes to Asia in search of enlightenment. And Agnes Varda came through the Walker, and one of the quick stories I can tell about Agnes Varda, it was when we were premiering her film, it was called The Gleaners and I, and she came to the Walker. First of all, she said, if I'm going to speak at 8 o'clock at night, I need to arrive from Paris at least 2 to 3 days in advance because I don't want to be tired at 8 o'clock at night because of jet lag. So we welcomed her to come early, and then we had these delightful days with her.
But when you see a full film and then you feel that the audience has well reacted and they love the film, they don't forget it. You know, I feel in a way that I'm sort of lucky.
The other thing she was preparing for was to receive a Lifetime Achievement Award in Paris when she got back. So one of the stories I told, one of the stories with her being here, not only did we visit all of the other art museums and had a lot of fun doing, just exploring the city, one of the things she wanted to do was to find something to wear for her Lifetime Achievement Award acceptance. And I said, well, we'll go shopping, of course. And she said, well, I want to go to secondhand stores only. So I went, Agnes Varda and I went around the city from one secondhand store to the other, and she found a wonderful outfit that she purchased, and she wore, in fact, that night to a dinner. And it was exciting to sort of spend some time with her in that way. But that's aside from the point. But it's kind of the stories that sometimes when people come from all over the world to spend days with us, and we get to be with them outside of their realm, just as a filmmaker and curator, but really to show them the city, to be a tour guide, to be involved in their life, to help them find something to wear for a Lifetime Achievement Award. Now, I don't know if she actually wore it or not, but we had fun looking for it. But Agnes Varda, of course, is someone who comes from the French New Wave and has been such an important filmmaker for such a long time, so it was an honor to have her here. The next three dialogues were really put together by Sis Behrings. In this time, Sis Behrings was hired to come to work at the Walker as a curator of film and video from Belgium, and he came and brought his expertise in a number of ways and his interest, and the three projects that he put together were Hanif Qureshi, the filmmaker who we called the Project Rough Guide to London, who was telling stories of what it was like, immigrant life in London at that time. And then Hedy Honingman, primarily a documentary filmmaker, Filming to the Heart. Again, another person who goes directly to telling a story that's very pure. And it was really wonderful to have her here as well. Gus Van Sant came next on the road, again, is what we called it, and it was a time where he had just made a film called Jerry. And Gus Van Sant was a filmmaker who had worked very independently and then did a lot of bigger pictures through the Hollywood system and had just reemerged. And one of the things we talk about a lot is when is the right time to bring a filmmaker to do a dialogue. And we felt that with Gus Van Sant, because he had just been working on, you know, had won a lot of awards for Finding Forrester. He had done Psycho as a remake back when we had done Fakes and Remakes a few years ago. But now he was really coming back into the pure essence of independent filmmaking with Jerry, and we said this is a time to bring Gus Van Sant to welcome him sort of back in this new way of working and to talk about this wonderful career that he's had.
Hardest sequence. I don't know, it just, when I remember like all the shoots, they all blend together into one big, like, you know, really difficult thing. So it's like, and it, I mean, some days it's hard sometimes when you have like, you know, I guess fights or things like that. But it really, it's kind of all kind of very consistently difficult.
The next person who came was Matthew Barney, and he is a filmmaker who had just completed at that time the Cree Master 5 sequence of films, the series of films. So we wanted to be able to show that complete program. And it was interesting because we had shown each of the Cree Masters when they were made, and with Matthew Barney, of course, everything is very interesting in many ways. And one is that he did the Cree Master films, but he made them out of order of the numbers, and he made them out of order, you know, in a number of ways. And so when we finally brought them all back together, we showed them Cree Master 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we also noted then that they, of course, moved from west to east geographically, and they really are a thematic arc, and it all sort of came together. So it was a perfect time with the completion of that to bring Matthew Barney here to speak. And he spoke with Richard Flood, our chief curator at that time. Frederick Wiseman, Sense of Place. And this one, you talk about what's the reason to bring someone at this moment. He is known, of course, as a documentary filmmaker, has made extraordinary work, and we were pleased to show as much of it as we could in his retrospective. But he had just made his first drama, and so that we thought that was really a time to bring him and to premiere that film. He's gone back to documentary since then, and he has a new film out that's just coming out, actually, I think this fall. Guy Madden, and we have worked with Guy Madden for many years prior to this as well, so it was really great to bring him for a Regis Dialogue. It's called Pages from a Filmmaker's Diary, and it was, we had a couple of things that happened with this extraordinary work. It was the premiere of Saddest Music in the World, which was a film that had in its cast Isabella Rossellini, which is where we met her, and sort of this is how we began a conversation with bringing her next. But also what his extraordinary work is, and fits so perfectly into a dusk to dawn kind of program. So the night that the Walker was closing its building to start the expansion, we did a dusk to dawn screening of all of Guy Madden's films back to back in chronological order that really went from throughout the night, and then at six o'clock or so in the morning when we finally completed the work, I think we went outside and it was the closing of the whole building, so there was a huge celebration going on, and you know, food trucks were there with coffee and donuts, and it was really kind of a moment in time. But this is what we did as our closing night event. While we were closing off site, we brought Pichapong Wirsethakul to do a Regis Dialogue and Retrospective, coming from Thailand. It was a program where he talked about all of the work that he was doing at that time. We did a retrospective that was held over at the Bell Auditorium on the University of Minnesota campus, and he did his talk at the Minneapolis College of Art and Design. And he became someone, again, that we have a long relationship with up until even this year, where he was our very first artist to do an artist commission work on the Walker Channel. So it's our beginning of a new way of working with him and working with artists. So that started, you know, with that dialogue. We've also shown all of his films since. We've done premieres of everything that he's done. Alexander Payne. So this one, we opened our new building, and this was the very first Regis Dialogue that we did in this space. Yeah, Sideways was the film that was just opening everywhere, and we did the local premiere of that film and brought Alexander Payne to talk about his career.
Notice when we cut to Kathy Bates and she's eating the pork chop and sucking her fingers, suddenly you hear the erhu, which is the Chinese upright violin like that. We had conceived of Denver as China somehow. It's just how what you get into, however arcane it is, and that she is the Dowager Queen. So in the film, basically, whenever you see her, you hear erhu.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Ang Lee and James Seamus. This is with the premiere of Brokeback Mountain. Again, one of the things that I always look for is when is the right moment to bring someone like Ang Lee, who had done such an array of work already. And we were very pleased that I had heard about this work through James Seamus. James Seamus is someone that I had known for a long time working with ITVS. He had done a big project together, and we'd always stayed in touch. He was at Focus Features and had produced Ang Lee's new film, and I really wanted it to be James Seamus to do the dialogue with Ang Lee. And we tracked this for a long, long time until we could finally get the right moment to be able to bring them both here and to be able to do the Minneapolis premiere of the film. And little did we know that the day that this was going to happen was, I think, the day that a lot of awards were announced, and Brokeback Mountain started winning. I think it won the Critics Award first and a number of things. So people were flying in from all over the country, all over the world, really, to interview Ang Lee here. And we did the interviews that morning here at the Walker, and they were all saying, so what are you doing in Minneapolis? I said, well, I'm here for the Walker, for the Regis Dialogue. And so we were happy to connect those things. So those moments when sometimes these things happen so perfectly, and that was one with Ang Lee.
When you love, as a filmmaker, when you love something, you feel passionate about it and you're obsessed, and then you insist on making a movie, inevitably you show, even though you don't give answer or statement, inevitably you show your attitude. I think that is revealed. That don't need me talking. Right. By just finishing the movie, I think the attitude is there.
Lily Taylor was such an independent spirit. We decided we had to bring Lily Taylor. She had been working on a film, Factotum, that was shot here. And it was exciting to meet her during that time that she was here. She came and spoke with B. Ruby Rich. And it was one of those stories where, mainly as an actress rather than a director, she has was intrigued with how the event went, because they were sitting on the stage and the films are projected in 35 millimeter in clips. And it's quite an extraordinary sense of being in a space with that, and having her look up and watch her career and have that engaged conversation she had with B. Ruby Rich, who was really a film critic, and able to talk with her about, in a way that she hadn't really thought of necessarily, of herself on screen in that way. So that was an exciting moment. Isabella Rossellini came as well, and as I said, we met during the through Guy Madden, and her film, because she's mainly known again as an actress, but her film that she had just made, which was My Father is 100 Years Old. And so I said to Isabella that this is a film series. The Regis Dialogues are primarily for directors. And she said, well, I've just made this marvelous film. And so we looked at it, and it was really, truly amazing. Telling the story, it was made in the honor of her father, Roberto Rossellini's, the anniversary of his 100th year of his birth. And so truly, truly amazing tale. And so she came and talked about that, as well as her work in films, including Blue Velvet.
And then I received a call from David Lynch, all excited. He said, it's going to be Dennis Hopper. Do you know him? And I said, sure, I know Dennis Hopper. What happened to him? Because we haven't heard from him in many years. He said, oh, he was just 3 years in rehab, but he just came out.
Michel Gondry, French filmmaker, who came to talk about his work, and again to do a wonderful retrospective that connected also to his music videos. I think he was very well known in music video as working so much with the many, many great musicians around the world, and then also doing, you know, Dave Chappelle's Block Party as a number of things. But The Science of Sleep was the new film at that time, and we were very excited to be able to show that. We also showed Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, and Michel Gondry was great to come here to, to the Walker to talk about his work. Bèla Tarr. Bèla Tarr, and I smile with this because this is a moment in time, I think, where Bèla Tarr came to the Walker when his new film, The Man from London, was being released, and we were able to do the screening of it. But one of my favorite films of his is Werkmeister Harmonies, and it is the thing that I think many of people discovered Bèla Tarr. So I was so pleased to be able to bring him to Minneapolis at that time and have a conversation about his films, and to show at that time his complete, a complete retrospective on 35mm of all of his films, which came over from Hungary on a big shipping pallet. I remember the, you know, of them all arriving, but to his early, early work all the way up to the present. The important little side note, I think, of that was he was able to meet a number of people in this community because he was here for several days. And one of the people that he met was Elizabeth Redley from Work, Work, Works Production, who later became involved in making the making of The Turin Horse. And she was the producer, one of the producers of that film. And that film, of course, is probably Bèla Tarr's. Not only does he say it's final, but is one of his most extraordinary arts works of art, which has then spurred on a number of other things, including a Jacques Rancière book that was just published here in Minneapolis, and so bringing a whole workshop and discussion of Bèla Tarr's work back to the foreground again just this past week.
And all of my movies, if you watch, it's always somewhere between the reality and the fiction, or I like to use a lot of real moments, and I like to involve a lot of improvisation, one hand, and the other hand, I like very much when everything is very well composed and perfect. That's what, how is, you know, Jean-Luc Godard said that once, the beauty and truth has two polar, the documents and the fiction or imagination.
Miloš Forman, Cinema of Resistance, someone from the Czech Republic who has made amazing films both before, you know, before his arrival in America, and we were able to show the complete retrospective going back all the way to his early, early work and then the transition to coming to America and the newer work of, you know, Goya's Ghost, The People versus Larry Flint, Amadeus, Hair, the fire, you know, amazing works. One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, of course, is probably what he's most known for.
I was 10 years old. My brother, who is 12 years older than I am, he was a set designer in a small touring theater company. And every time they were in the town I was living at the time, at that moment, he took me backstage. I was 10 years old, little kid, nobody paid any attention to me. So I spent all the evenings in the ladies' dressing room. And I was fascinated.
Like the young Bob Fosse.
Yeah.
And all that.
They were changing costumes, you know, in front of me. And the fragrance of makeup and everything. And they were goddesses to me. You know, these singers and dancers, operetta, you know, fluffy music, you know. And then I noticed that there is one man there whom all these goddesses are looking up to like he was a super god. And I asked my brother, who is the man? And he says, oh, he's a director. That was it. I want to be a director.
Talking about moments is that as we progress through these Regis Dialogues, one of our moments was realizing how important it was to make sure that these were available to the world beyond the audience here just at the Walker. And so the interest in making sure that they were put up online on the Walker channel became really an important point at this moment in time. And so what we did, in a sense, when we had these very beautiful brochures that I was showing you before, what we ended up doing is putting the energy and the time and the financing, you know, the support for this into editing and getting the works all up online. So I don't have anything else now to hold up to show, to talk about the next, but I'm hoping we can go to some clips if we can online and show what is there, because it's an incredible wealth of history that is available for those filmmakers who have given us permission to put them online. And for those who chose not to, they are in our archive, so people can come here and watch them. So we can go in either way. But so after the next was to bring William Klein, and William Klein is an artist and filmmaker who, again, we have a long relationship with at the Walker, not only doing exhibitions that Bruce did many years ago, but also to bring him back and to put his, contain all of his films in the Reuben Benson film collection and to be the distributor for those films around the world. So it was thrilling to bring him here and have him talk about his career and to be able to show all of those works. The next dialogue was our 50th, so we thought it should be very celebratory. It was also the 20th anniversary of the program, so in the sense of having a moment of time to recognize, it was also came together beautifully because it was a perfect time for Joel and Ethan Coen to come to the Walker. And this is, two brothers who grew up in Minneapolis who came to the Walker as children. And I'd been in touch with them for several years trying to find a perfect time for them to come for a Regis Dialogue, and it just became that this was the moment. It came together for many reasons. One is they had completed the film A Serious Man, and which was shot in Minneapolis, or this area, and it was time for before it was released, and we did the cast and crew screening here at the Walker, and then Joel and Ethan Coen came to talk about their work and their their retrospective. It was great to be able to show a complete retrospective of all of their films. And then they joined on stage with Elvis Mitchell and talked extensively about ideas and literature and a lot of things other than just their films. So it was an extraordinary conversation.
When you guys were kids, did you make movies that were chase movies? I mean, were you doing genre movies and you were shooting movies around here with your Super 8 camera?
Actually, we did make some chase movies, yeah. With Super 8 cameras.
This is deep. It's true.
Yeah. We did. We made one of the great chase movies was the very first movie we made with the Super 8, remade with the Super 8 camera, which was The Naked Prey, the Cornell Wilde movie.
You made that?
We made that here. With a friend from the neighborhood. And so you're right. It all started out with chase movies. I have to say, though, in our own defense, the next movie we adapted with the Super 8 camera, these were both like 3-minute versions of it, was the Alan Drury novel, Advising Consent.
The next was Kelly Reichert, who had just finished a film called Wendy and Lucy and was working on Meek's Cutoff, which was a film that we were looking at showing as well. A young filmmaker, one of the things that we try to do with this program is to balance out people that are younger and less known against the great filmmakers of our time. And it was really terrific to bring Kelly Reichert here to talk about her work kind of as a real footloose filmmaker who travels off the beaten track, as we call this. Next, Olivia Assayas came from France, from Paris, in a conversation with Kent Jones. It was a premiere of his epic work, Carlos, at that time, which was just about to be released, a 5-hour amazing film about Carlos the Jackal, and his interest in really exploring what was really now very contemporary issues once again in the rise of early terrorism in the 1970s. So we called his talk Between Love and Terror, because certainly his early work is much more about falling in love and just the growing up in France. Next, Julian Schnabel came to talk with our chief curator, then Darcy Alexander, and with the premiere of his new film, Morale. And Julian Schnabel is someone who comes from the art world and works very equally in film and film production. It's always nice to see how artists are able to make that transition. But before that, we had Harry Belafonte come to the Walker with a film that had been made about him called Sing Your Song, and we were very happy to have him come here and talk in what we called Singing Your Song, because it's really telling his story of what he's done both as an activist. Larry Kasdan, you know, is such a quintessential filmmaker. It has looked at the history of what's happened in America, or just the way we've all grown up in a way over time. So we were really pleased to be able to bring him back to the Walker with his film Darling Companion to speak with Scott Fondas about his career.
I grew up in a relatively small town. It wasn't a small town for West Virginia, but it was a small town. And movies always were a magical place for me, and they used to say, you know, you'd call the theater and say, what time's the show? And they'd say, what time can you be here?
You understand in this program, I was surprised that really there was only one instance of that in this entire now, you know, almost 60 filmmaker list. But Claire Denis was someone I was able to meet up with at other film festivals, and I asked her about this, if she would come back, and she always felt yes, she would make that effort, because she felt that she had really owed us one, as she would say, yes, I'll be there. So we tried to find a perfect time to bring Claire Denis, and it was nice to have her here last fall and to be able to show her work in a great retrospective of her films, and to have her be able to tell those stories of from chocolate to white material.
Because, of course, this doubt is always there. Is there going to be a film in the end, you know? Who knows? I'm not sure. But if this doubt is everywhere on the set, then the crew could feel it, the actors could feel that doubt. So I think I have found this way of losing myself in a lot of stress and anxiety that keep me away from the killing doubt, you know?
Then Noah Baumbach. When I saw Frances Ha as a film, I just thought this was an amazing story, and it was great, would be great, perfect timing to bring Noah Baumbach to come and talk about his career as well. So Noah was able to come and talk with Scott Fondas last year.
Like, I knew what the auteur theory was, which again, at nine, you should know what the auteur theory is. You should just be excited that images flicker and move so I was into Ivan Reitman. I would sort of embrace this sort of the auteur theory of Harold Ramis, right. Ivan Reitman, John Landis, right. and then sort of fight with my parents about it. But my parents also were cool, because I think they particularly my dad and I saw a lot of these movies. The R thing again was a big thing, because I wasn't allowed to see R-rated movies until I lived in Park Slope in Brooklyn, and there was a theater that had been defunct. It had been a porn theater, and then it was just didn't. And then suddenly, it like around the time that I was nine, it became, it was happening again, right. And so I was suddenly that now that our movies were local, I could go see them, and because we
it
could
makes
walk
perfect
to
sense.
Them. Yeah, yeah. Somehow driving to them was like not the child shouldn't see these things. But now as local, my father was like, we can see The Jerk. I remember because I saw The Jerk, Animal House, and I was like, this is great. And then he took me to Apocalypse Now as the third R. and then it was like, maybe we.
Our next Regis Dialogue is Steve McQueen. Steve McQueen is the British filmmaker whose work Hunger and Shame has marked him as a significant feature filmmaker and storyteller, but also has a vast body of work as an artist, both in sculpture and primarily in video installation. Things like that have shown at the Walker as well in exhibitions. But he's just coming off of a major exhibition of his work, a 20-year retrospective that is being shown, was shown in Chicago and in Basel, Switzerland, just recently. So this is a chance to really combine his work as an artist and his work as a filmmaker to talk with Stuart Comer, who is the chief curator of media and performance at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and who is just before that from the Tate Modern in London, so they know each other from both spaces. So this will be an interesting conversation about art and cinema.
My wife said to me, why didn't you sort of look into true accounts of slavery? Sorry. She found this book in both our research called 12 Years a Slave, and as soon as I had the book in my hand, it's kind of strange that sometimes you have an idea and it's formalized. It is there already, especially as a screenplay. And it's like, my goodness, this idea is there. And that was it, really.
And that we're going to be able to do the premiere of 12 Years a Slave is just perfect, again, that this is a film that has just completed and coming through the festival circuit at both Telluride, Toronto, and actually playing this weekend at the New York Film Festival. And then we'll be coming to the Walker next. It's an exciting moment. So that's sort of the Regis Dialogue Program, the MacArthur, Regis, and now Mike and Anita Kunin-funded dialogue program at the Walker. And it is, as we said in the very beginning, a place where we bring the most innovative, exciting filmmakers of our time. And when you look back at this history, it's pretty amazing who has been here. And it really, and not only, again, for the people who were in the room, but now this opportunity to see many of these online on the Walker channel is just a terrific history.